Welcome to the United States of America. Next.
Your name, please.
Eva Siburska. She's my sister. Is something wrong?
She has to be deported.
No! We never go back!
You speak English?
Yes. Can you help me? Please.
You're a very lucky lady. Do you have a place to stay?
Do you know somewhere?
Yeah, I know a place.
And get her off the island, whether she's cured or not. I know people. It'd be difficult and costly, but it can be done.
I need to work.
Or I can take you to my place of business.
Set in immigration in the 1920s. Do you see any sort of parallel for your film for immigration now?
Of course, in some respects, most respects, the world is much better than it was in 1923 or 21. You can't romanticize the past. But having said that fact, I think, there is clear evidence that in some small way there was a measure of ambition that the country had, which was amazing. And the fact that Ellis Island's hospital, we know what Joaquin says in the beginning of the picture, he says, so you're the very best medical care available, was true. The Ellis Island Hospital was the best hospital in the United States. And they had Caruso singing for the immigrants. I mean, what's the equivalent of that today? I said last night, I was like Beyonce walking into the Social Security office and serenading, you know, like, well, I would never do that, right? And it does speak to the ambition of the country. Look, Ellis Island, when it was built, it was first 1 by 2 acres. It was a very small island. And the island became much bigger from landfill, from the New York subway tunnels that were being dug. And it was a wooden building first. In 1892, they built it. And it burned down under very mysterious circumstances, 1897, some kind of arson. And when they had to build the new building, they didn't say, let's build like that, you know, those crappy, like, drop ceiling fluorescent light municipal spaces which make your spirit die. No, they said, we're going to build this amazing Beaux-Arts building which is going to make you drool. And that's what's there. And to me, that speaks to an ambition. That's the country that did the Brooklyn Bridge. You know, that's like, you come into this country, we're going to show you what's possible. And I feel, despite the fact that the country is 100 billion times better in almost every way, that we've lost that, the aim for greatness in a way. So the difficult time that I have with the question that you ask, which is a valid and a good one about parallels to today, is that it's not an easy answer, that there's some aspects which are, of course, better today, but there are some that are not.
Let's talk a little bit about presentation and how you use costume as an extra story angle. Like, she dresses as Lady Liberty, the daughters of the richest men of the city.
That's from a hooker's handbook we found from 1916. Joaquin found it. It was a pamphlet they would read from. Lady Astor, that whole speech he gives, is from an actual handbook from being a hooker in 1900. We found that. We just thought that was the greatest thing in the world. We had to put that in the movie somewhere. And so the look of the film, the costumes, all of that was extremely important to us. And I went kind of crazy. And a lot of it is actual authentic antiques that they're wearing. Because the costume designer was this woman named Patricia Norris, who's just genius. And she, just to let you know, she did Al Pacino's ridiculous suits and scarfs. She's done every movie ever. She's like a genius. And she's like, I have access to all the real stuff. Don't worry about a thing. And she just brought out all these antiques that the actors wore. And you look at these costumes. By the way, Joaquin Phoenix's suit, it was like the thickness of a nuclear containment center. I mean, it was like the thread count on that thing. I mean, it was built like you couldn't. Because one time when, you know, the cops are beating him up in the tunnel, and I said, this doesn't look realistic to me. You know, these tears in the suit, it looks like he just bought it. And Patricia turned to me and said, honey, take a look at what this thing is. And she was like taking like razors to it, nothing was happening to it. Because back then they bought basically two suits and they lasted the whole, you know, your whole life. And so all of that stuff is in the movie, you know, an attempt to make it as authentic feeling as possible. And I had a great aunt. She just died last year. She was 101. And she was quite lucid to the end, really. And she told me about this guy named Max Hoxton, who was the local pimp, and he had this group of women, and he was mercurial and sometimes prone to fits of rage in front of everybody, but a lot of times he was pretentious and very sweet, and he would say, hello. And he was like this in the restaurant. He would always come in, and I thought, well, that's an interesting guy. So I started to research him, that pimp guy. And there's a great book by a writer, if you've never read it, you should, by a guy named Luc Sant called Lowlife, about this period in New York from about 1860 to about 1920. And when I started to read about corrupt officials at Ellis Island who would help him bring single women into the country, the tradition was called white slavery. I thought, well, I've never seen a movie on that.
Did you actually shoot on Ellis Island?
We did, and it was one of, like, the biggest catastrophes logistically ever. Because, you know, you sit around and you write these things in the comfort of your own apartment, and you write, you know, 800 immigrants in the Great Hall at Ellis Island, and then all of a sudden you go and you realize, oh, wait a minute, I actually have to shoot this. And I remember the line producer, trust me, my imitation is perfect.
Jimmy, it's kind of cool, you know, what you wrote here, but do we really have to do this at Ellis Island?
I said, well, where do you want to shoot it, in Staples?
He goes, no, but I mean, it's kind of hard, you know, I mean, what do we do?
So I thought, you know, because my ego was rather large, I decided I would go to Ellis Island and I would charm the woman that works for the National Park Service. This meeting did not go well. I remember I walked in and I said, so I'm a movie director and I'm going to bring actors here you may have even heard of. We're going to shoot this movie here. And she went, I'm sorry, what do you want to do? I said, well, we're going to make a movie here at Ellis Island. It's, you know, she's like, the tourist does not want that experience. And I knew I was in really deep shit. So I said, okay, well, the tourist. Well, I said, well, the tourist will see cameras and actors and period, you know, 800, that'll be amazing. The tourist doesn't want that, and we are open 362 days out of the year, young man. I'm like, what would be the three you aren't? Christmas, New Year's, Thanksgiving. And you could tell her attitude was, beat that motherfucker. Like 3 days you can't possibly shoot, right? So I then had the rather brilliant idea of shooting Ellis Island at night for day. And the line producer, I kind of suckered him into it because I told him, I said, I have no interest in making the picture. If I can't do it at Ellis Island, what am I going to do? So then there was discussion about doing it in like a virtual green room where, like, you know, like Frodo and Smaug would make an appearance or something, you know, like Peter Jackson style. And I realized, well, this is not a fantasy movie. You can't really do that. And the actors don't really know where you're looking, you know, and it's really bizarre. And I thought, well, this is not practical after about a minute. I thought, that's it. I'm not making the movie. I'm not doing it. So I then finally said, I'm going to do it at night. And he said, okay, I think that's possible. And we negotiated with the Parks Department. And by the way, I am unfairly criticizing them, because to have a crew in there, you know you're going to screw up a national landmark. Right. You just are. You can have 200 people, and they're like, Tommy, bring the light down to the floor. You know, it's going to be this. And then, like, the Gustavino tiles, which are, like, priceless. The whole ceiling's going to be fucking destroyed, you know. So anyway, so I say, okay, let's shoot at night. And then you realize the last ferry leaves at 5:30 in the evening. So you've got to dress everyone in Lower Manhattan, bring them by ferry at 5:30 at night to Ellis Island to sit for hours until you've lit. Lunch is at 2 a.m. They don't have a working kitchen at Ellis Island, so then you've got to bring in the lunch. I can't tell you those conversations. Extras coming up to me. Mr. Gary? Yes. The lunch sucked. You're the director, right? Yes. Lunch sucked. It was cold. I'm like, I understand that, but we had to bring it, you know, because it's Ellis Island. And then that great hall, like I say, with the Gustavino tiling and all that magnificent space, is on the second and third floor of Ellis Island. So then you've got to bring these 10K lights to light 18, 25-foot high Beaux-Arts windows on barges, cranes on barges. It was crazy. But we did it. 2 days. And the first day was the day stuff, which is the opening of the film, where she's interviewed by the customs official. And then the second was the recreation of the Caruso concert. And that had to be night for night. That was much easier. But the day for night stuff was murder.
You know, with all these impersonations, I see why Wes Anderson has been trying to cast you in a movie.
He's not going to succeed. But the story that I've told, which is completely true. In fact, my friend who directed Love Jones, Ted Witcher, is here. I acted in my friend Ted's movie, and I was obviously not actually in Love Jones in the end, so that should tell you how good I was. And Wes was going to cast me in The Life Aquatic, and he called me and he said,
it'll be great, we'll do 5 months, and 5 weeks in Cinecittà, it'll be amazing, it'll be Rome, you and I will eat lots of pasta.
I know, that's pretty good. And then like I got sent like a day to days, and it was like 2 months, or no, 3 months, and then I thought, well, there's no way that's going to be 3 months. And then of course it wound up being like, 18 months or something. Like, it would be like a disaster. And then anyway, the point is that once Wes heard that I had been cut out of the other movie, let's just say he wasn't I wasn't the first call he was making anymore. So I constantly kind of go like this,
I read that you cast Marion Cotillard after she threw a dinner roll at you.
But really, I got the idea to make the film. I went to dinner with her and with her boyfriend in Paris, and we were arguing over the merits of somebody, and she threw bread at me because she got really frustrated. I like to say because she couldn't support her argument at all, but it's more likely that I was just being an ass. And she threw the bread at me, and she said, "You don't know what you're talking about." And I loved that. I thought that was great because she has like a great face, obviously, for movies. It's like a silent movie actress, and a very a great will also, which was revealed to me in that moment. And what I had intended for was a character that was not at all a kind of saint. And, you know, in the film, she's constantly pulling out weapons, potentially, and, you know, bargaining with him, saying things like, "I want half your money." Like, she's got, like, a survival chip in her, but it's a very quiet, it's like the mask, the face is a mask behind which, you know, and she lies to the doctor in the beginning. The sister does have tuberculosis. So I thought that was an interesting thing to promote this person with this great face who was also kind of had a will.
Well, this is your first film with a female lead. Why was that important for this narrative or for you as a filmmaker?
I don't know the answer to either of those two questions. What I can tell you is that I thought I wanted to do something where I didn't rely on, like, you know, a bunch of guys wearing, like, leather jackets, like, screaming fuck at each other and, like, running around holding guns. I wanted to do something which was openly emotional without being sentimental and, in a sense, to kind of rid myself of the macho tropes, you know, and to make it very operatic, where a woman, which was something that like Puccini might do, make the woman at the center, you know, like Tosca or Suor Angelica or La Rondina, which is what Caruso is singing. So to me, it just seemed very much in that tradition, you know, as a kind of fallen doves, they would call them. So I thought, well, that's, you know, make it about her.
But in release terms, that you've been a filmmaker for 20 years, if you could, we'll add some sci-fi element, if you could go back and talk to yourself back then and or give advice about how independent film has changed, or to wannabe filmmakers now, what would you say about the current state of cinema with your own 20-year mark?
Well, I would say that the state of cinema is a complicated one. I would say it's, in many ways, quite bleak, because the idea of watching a movie like this in a theater is not, I don't want to say coming to an end, but is reaching a new kind of step where you now have VOD, and I think VOD is terrific, and Apple TV is the best thing that ever happened to my movie watching, because all I do, like, tonight I'm going to watch Mrs. Miniver with Greer Garson, click, and I'm watching it, and that's great. But there's a communal experience right here, and you can love it or hate it together, and you can laugh or be miserable together at it. And that's a valuable commodity. And what I find with the VOD is that that will be lost. So for the type of films that I like, I think there aren't enough movie houses that can sustain it. But, you know, for Godzilla, the world is great, right? You make Godzilla, everybody goes. Now, I don't really understand that myself, because people who say they want to see Godzilla to me, and a lot of people do, obviously, I say, well, there's a movie that you might see then called Godzilla. And if you don't like that Godzilla, the one with Raymond Burr, there's another film called Godzilla vs. King Kong. And if you don't like that, there's Godzilla from Roland Emmerich. And then if you don't like that, there's Cloverfield, which is sort of Godzilla. And if you don't like Cloverfield, well, now there's a new Godzilla. There's a lot of Godzilla. So I just feel like what has happened is there's a kind of McDonald'sization to cinema, where the movies that everybody wants to see have pretty much, it's a 99% 1% world. And it's the same way with cinema. Those movies are pushing out the smaller pictures. So I hope I'm wrong. I hope there's a generation of young people that comes up that is interested in new films and or films that are at least personal in some way. But it's very hard, because what happens is that, well, I've used this analogy many times. If you give everybody a McDonald's hamburger every day, and then you try to give them, you know, halibut sushi, the instinct is not, this is delicious, right? The instinct is, what the hell is this? So it has to do with how the audience is educated, and I think that has been vastly changed in the last 20 years.
Well, thank you very much for
thanks for coming, guys.
It's not matter what you do. You got a right to be happy, Eva.